We present Surface Map Homology Inference. I am Janis Born, and this is a collaboration with Patrick Schmidt and Leif Kobbelt from RWTH Aachen and Marcel Campen from Osnabrück University. Many methods in geometry processing deal with maps between surfaces. Of particular importance are continuous bijective maps or homeomorphisms. They define a geometrical correspondence of surface points, but they also imply a topological correspondence. They identify matching handles and tunnels and describe how the map twists around them. However, in practice, surface maps are often encoded in ways that are not proper homeomorphisms. For example, sampled maps that encode only a finite number of point-to-point correspondences. Such representations are neither continuous nor bijective, and therefore inherently ambiguous about the underlying map topology. Nevertheless, if the sampling approximates some homeomorphism well enough, we can intuitively guess the topology of the approximated map. In this work, we propose an automatic method to recover this information. Given some approximate input map, we robustly infer a purely topological map description in the form of a so-called homology map. It encodes the map topology by describing how equivalence classes of cycles are mapped from one surface to the other. Our inference is robust to many types of map defects, such as noise, gaps, outliers or non-injectivities, and always produces a description of a valid homeomorphism. It also captures deliberate topological features of the input map. For example, if the input indicates a twist around a handle, then this twist will also be inferred in the homology map. Such homology maps can then be used to transfer data between the two shapes or to guide the construction of compatible surface decompositions. Our topological map representation is built on the concept of homology, which describes an equivalence relation between cycles on surfaces. A cycle is an oriented closed loop embedded in a surface. Two cycles can be composed by addition, which superimposes them, while parts with opposite orientation cancel. Some cycles are topologically interesting because they wind around handles or tunnels of the surface. Others just enclose some region of the surface. These are called boundary cycles, and we use them to define homology. If you can take one cycle and modify it by adding only boundary cycles to obtain another one, then we say that those two cycles are homologous. Under this relation, each cycle is part of some equivalence class of mutually homologous cycles, called a homology class. While the cycles within the homology class can be geometrically different, what they all have in common is the number of times they wind around certain handles of the surface. In the following, we illustrate homology classes by just showing one cycle that acts as a representative. When we add two cycles, the homology class of the result only depends on the homology classes of the summons, not their particular shapes, so we can consider cycle addition directly as an operation on homology classes. In fact, the set of all homology classes of a surface has a very convenient linear representation. For a surface of genus G, you can find some set of 2G cycles that act as a homology basis. Then, any homology class is represented by an integer linear combination of these basis cycles. That means you can encode any homology class just as an integer vector within this basis. Now consider two surfaces, A and B. Assume there is an homeomorphism F that maps between them. Since it is continuous, we can use it to map cycles from A to B. Indeed, this action of F on cycles also induces a well-defined map between homology classes of the two surfaces. We obtain a so-called induced homology map that uniquely associates each homology class of A with a corresponding homology class of B. For both surfaces, we can choose homology bases, allowing us to represent homology classes using coefficients. Then, the homology map can be expressed as a map between those two coefficient representations. Each integer vector encodes some homology class on A, which gets mapped over to B, where it is expressed by some other vector. As it turns out, this induced mapping is linear, so it can be represented by just an integer matrix M that maps between the coefficients. However, not every integer matrix corresponds to a homology map that is actually induced by some homeomorphism. The class of valid homology maps can be characterized by an additional constraint on M, which basically states that if two cycles intersect a certain number of times on A, then the images on B must have the same intersection number. This property can be concisely stated in terms of two additional constant matrices omega A, omega B, which just contain the pairwise intersection numbers of the homology basis cycles. Every matrix M that fulfills this constraint describes a homology map that is indeed induced by some homeomorphism from A to B. This purely topological map representation is exactly what we want to infer. But remember that in practice, the input map is not given as an actual homeomorphism, but by some approximation of it, like this sampled surface map. If we could use this map to transfer representative cycles from A to B, we could immediately read off the induced homology map. But since the input is non-continuous, this is not directly possible. We could try to approximate the transfer of cycles by mapping certain points and connecting them somehow, but this can be quite unreliable. If the map is unevenly sampled or contains outliers, this mapping is susceptible to local defects and may easily fail due to a bad choice of representative cycles. Instead of trying to map local, high-frequency information in the form of cycles, we propose an alternative approach involving smooth, low-frequency fields that can be globally mapped and compared in a way that is tolerant to local errors. We find this representation by switching from homology to its analogous dual concept, which is cohomology. While homology talks about cycles, the objects of cohomology are cocycles, which are closed one-forms on a surface. You can think of them as curl-free vector fields. The cocycles that are topologically interesting are fields that flow around handles. But there are also cocycles that are just gradient fields of some scalar potential. These are known as co-boundaries. As before, we say that two cocycles are cohomologous if they differ only by some co-boundary. This gives rise to the notion of cohomology classes. All elements of one cohomology class are fields with the same global flow behavior around handles. We can also pick a cohomology basis, a set of basis cocycles, and then every cohomology class is represented by some linear combination. Given some homology basis, there is a natural way to choose the corresponding dual cohomology basis. This duality is defined in terms of integrals. For every basis cycle, the corresponding basis cocycle integrates to 1 along the associated basis cycle and to 0 along all others. Additionally, we require that these cocycles are harmonic, that means as smooth as possible. This uniquely defines a canonical dual cohomology basis. Just as a homeomorphism between two surfaces induces a homology map by mapping cycles, it also induces a cohomology map by mapping cocycles. For a given basis, the homology map is represented by an integer matrix, and we can do the same for the cohomology map. Due to our dual choice of bases, we can now easily convert between homology and cohomology maps. One is simply the inverse transpose of the other. This allows us to perform our map inference in the cohomology setting and then just convert the result to a homology map. Still, the question remains how we can map cocycles when the input map is actually sparse and possibly unreliable. The key insight is that we can represent a cocycle as a scalar field by integrating it across the surface. By construction, this creates a continuous periodic signal that oscillates with the flow of the cocycle. Now we can use the sparse input map to transport values of the signal from A to B at corresponding sample locations. Next, we extend this sparse mapping to a dense continuous field on the target surface. Using harmonic interpolation, we fill gaps and consolidate noise or outliers. Finally, we convert back to a cocycle by locally differentiating the mapped signal on the target surface. With this operation, transporting cocycles from A to B, we are finally ready to describe our inference algorithm. Again, we start with two surfaces AB and an input map between them, approximating an unknown homeomorphism. First, we compute homology bases of the two surfaces. Our goal is to find the matrix that maps between them. Next, we compute the corresponding dual cohomology bases. we now use the input map to transport the basis cocycles from A to B. This goes through the process of integrating two periodic potentials on A, mapping to B with interpolation, and differentiating again to obtain cocycles. At this point, we have two sets of cocycles on surface B. Its original cohomology basis and the cohomology basis from A mapped over to B. Under an ideal map, these mapped basis cocycles from A are just integer linear combinations of basis cocycles of B, and this linear map is exactly the cohomology map. In practice, we find the integer matrix that best aligns these two sets of basis fields in a least square sense. We measure the field similarity across the entire surface, which makes the inference robust to potential local mapping errors. We add the constraint that only allows cohomology maps induced by homeomorphisms, which restricts to topologically valid results. In this formulation, our inference task is a quadratic minimization problem over integer variables, the entries of the matrix, under quadratic equality constraints. Since the number of variables is relatively small, it only depends on the genus, this can be efficiently solved by off-the-shelf branch and bound solvers. The resulting matrix is a cohomology map, and we can immediately convert it to finally give us the desired homology map. This way of inferring maps is indeed extremely robust against various common map defects. As an experiment, we used this pair of genus 3 shapes and a densely sampled map between them. Our method easily infers the correct homology map in this case. We illustrate it by showing representative cycles and their images. We now artificially add noise to this input map by randomly moving sample positions on the target surface. The inferred map remains unchanged, even for large perturbations. Only for extremely degraded inputs, the inference eventually reports a different, but still valid result. Similarly, we simulate outliers by randomly swapping sample positions on the target surface. Here we still infer the correct map if up to 60% of the samples are permuted. Finally, we measure the effect of map sparsity by incrementally removing corresponding samples. In this example, the inference result is not affected until we drop all but 10 samples of the input map. This high tolerance to errors allows us to quickly generate valid homology maps from ad hoc inputs, for example, sampled maps generated by a rough extrinsic alignment and nearest neighbor projections. Although the resulting map contains discontinuities, gaps, and non-injective overlaps, it still suffices for the inference of the desired map topology. Another common input are shapes with landmark annotations, which can be seen as cases of extremely sparse sampled maps. Here we infer the intended homology map despite the sparsity and geometrical dissimilarity of the two objects. Our method is easily adapted to other map representations. We directly support any type of map that can be used to transport scalar fields from one mesh to the other, such as functional maps. The fact that functional maps are fuzzy and can only map very smooth signals is not an issue due to our inference in the cohomology setting. One direct application of homology maps is the transfer of data between homology bases. For example, we can use an inferred homology map to transfer the turning behavior of a direction field from one surface to another. Similarly, we can map the flow of harmonic vector fields from surface to surface using a cohomology map. Another application is the construction of actual homeomorphisms from surface decompositions. Generally, we can cut two surfaces to disks and then overlay them to obtain a homeomorphism, where the map topology depends on the embeddings of the two cut graphs. But without any notion of topological correspondence, the cuts may be embedded in very different ways on the two objects. However, if we have a meaningful input map, we can use the inferred homology map to guide the cut graph construction. For each cut path on A, we map its homology class to B and then find a path in that homology class. With this method, we obtain cut graphs and a resulting homeomorphism of the desired topology, which can now be further improved by a continuous geometric optimization. This example shows another challenging case of a pair of genus 12 objects. Generally, homology provides an adequate description of map topology, but there are certain limits to its expressiveness. Some topological features cannot be captured by homology, such as this twist. Although these two loops cannot be continuously deformed into one another, they are in fact homologous. This is an example of the difference between homology and homotopy, which also affects the topology of maps. While this only matters for somewhat exotic map topologies, it would be desirable to have a full inference in terms of homotopy, which is, however, much more challenging as it is no longer a linear concept. Also, in its current formulation, our method is restricted to closed surfaces. An extension to surfaces with boundaries would be certainly useful, but there the duality between homology and cohomology no longer exists in this simple form. If you are interested to learn more about our work, check out our project page for the paper and feel free to reach out if you have any further questions.